So I am expecting a lot of students will join the class, whether they are aware of it or not. If they are not aware of it, then please inform to your classmates to join the class immediately. This course in NPTEL, every week they will release the video lectures and also the feedback form, practice assignment and quiz also will be given for every week. Now already they have released week 3 video lectures and also assignment. Before I start the week 1 course and the assignment solutions, let me tell you briefly that what you have to do the task for this course without fail, right? So every week they will provide the assignment, and for every assignment deadline will be given. You need to submit the assignment before the deadline. Once deadline is crossed, then you cannot submit the assignment. And remember, why do we need to submit this assignment? Because for internal marks, it is 25 and for external marks, it is 75 as you are writing for the JNTUH subject, right? So in the same way, for all these assignments, so this course, Data Science for Engineers course, is an 8-week course. Already third week is also started. So every week they will provide the assignment with the deadline, and you have to submit the solutions to this assignment. Finally, for all the 8 assignments, they will take the best of 6, and then out of best of 6, whatever the average score you will obtain out of 25, that score will be considered as internal marks, and external marks will be 75. That is, you are going to write an external exam with the selected center, with the selected center in Hyderabad, with the selected center. Then there you have to go and write the CBT, computer based test for external, that is for 75 marks. So here the course description is also given, and also there are some constraints to obtain the NPTEL course certificate. That is, for example, Data Science for Engineers course. So now you can get this certificate when you are eligible and meeting the certain criteria. That criteria is that for internal marks, out of 25, you need to score the minimum marks, that is 10 above. And also for the external exam, out of 75, you have to secure minimum 35 or above. If you don't meet any of this criteria, either in internal score or either in external score, then you are not passed in this course. You are not passed in this course and you will not be getting the certificate. When you don't get the pass certificate for this course, then in JNTUH, this subject will be considered as failed for particular student. So that's why it is very, very important to submit the assignments within the deadline. And why we need to complete this course and obtain the pass certificate? The reason is that this score is used for the credit transfer in JNTU. So this is mandatory, as I already informed to all of you by conducting a meeting with CRs, second year CRs, that why we have to register NPTEL courses and what is the need of writing an exam and what is the eligibility criteria to get the certificate. And this score will be submitted to JNTUH, and based on that score you will be awarded with a eligible grade, and then the credit transfer will be done. If the subject is for 2 credits, then 2 credits. If the subject is for 3 credits, as JNTU decided, so then those credits will be credited. Those credits will be transferred. Otherwise, if you don't get the pass certificate for this course, then you will not be that. That's what. Then you will be getting the failed. You will be getting the information as failed or F grade. So that's why make sure that all the students will submit the assignments within the deadline. Once the deadline is crossed, I cannot help, your mentor cannot help, nobody can help you on that. You will be losing the score for the internal. As I already told that, the meeting eligibility criteria for internal and external. So please do remember these, points. And how many of you have gone through this week one video lectures? Can anyone respond? Did anybody is aware of our programming? Did anybody is, any student is aware of our programming? And what is the purpose of this course? What we can learn from this course? Data science for engineers, fine. What we can learn from this course? The main objective of outcomes from this course is that we can do the data analysis on different areas. We can do the data analysis on different fields, either in healthcare sector or financial sector or educational sector, education side. You know, there are different fields. So we can do the data analysis, that is the basic data analysis, not an advanced, basic data analysis in any of the field, in any of the field. So in order to learn the content or learn the topics from this course, you need to practice our programming. You need to practice our programming. So you need to be aware of the basic concepts of R. Basic concepts of R, right? So what we can learn the topics from week one course is that what you can learn from the course, that's what I have informed just now, that we can do the data analysis on different fields. That is for the basic thing. For advanced, then you need to learn the data analytics and the some more advanced topics. And this is for the beginners. We can perform the data analysis for a few parameters, considering the few parameters. And then introduction to R. What we can learn from R and what are the variables and data types available in R, and what do you mean by a data frame, and in data frame what are all the operations can be performed, and arithmetic, logical and matrix operations in R, and how we write the functions and execute the functions in R, and what are the control structures available in R, and data visualization in R. Okay, I will give an brief information on these topics. If you go through the video lectures, then you will you have to go through the video lectures. You have to go through the video lectures, and you need to understand the understand the topic, then only you will be able to solve the assignment. So before we go into the course, you need to install an R and R Studio setup. You have to install R and R Studio. And this setup guide document is available in NPTEL course itself. When you log in into that course, here you have a setup guide. So you can click on this setup guide and you can go through that information to it, which will help you to install the R and RStudio. I have installed with the help of this only. I hope you are all able to see this document also, right? So now what it says, the first step, installation of R, go to this website. And when you go to this website and you will select the package, make sure that that package is compatible with your operating system. That is either Ubuntu Linux or Mac or Windows. So just you choose that package which is compatible with your operating system. That is important. After that, installation of RStudio, then you can click on this link and obviously you select the package which is compatible with your operating system. Then this will help you to install R. This will help you to install RStudio. So now, once RStudio is installed, then you need to install the packages which are very, very important to be installed. Then only you can access few things directly if you install the packages. Like in C or C++ or Java, we upload the libraries, and then when the libraries are imported or uploaded, then directly we can use commands or functions. So in the same manner, here also packages are given, and you need to install these packages in RStudio. These two are, you know, when you click on these links, then it will give the instructions. Follow those instructions and install. Now, how to install the packages, that I will tell you. So now for this purpose, you have to go to the RStudio and explore the environment. Now, while installing the packages, you can give in console install.packages of these are packages. So here for R programming, these are the packages required. When you are working on linear algebra, then these packages are required. When you are performing probability and statistics modeling, then these packages are required. And for predictive modeling, these packages are required. For data preparation after analysis, then these packages are required. For machine learning, in this course, we are going to learn few machine learning algorithms in order to perform the data analysis also. So for those machine learning algorithms, these are the packages to be installed. Otherwise, we cannot perform such operations if the required packages are not installed. Anyway, forget about this step. I will tell you in an easy method. So in my system, R console and R studio are installed. As soon as you can see here, this is R studio and this is R console. So this is R, and mine is an 64-bit operating system. So it is showing like that, the compatible, and the version is 4.1.0. And this is an R studio. When you click on this, it will open R. When you click on this, it will open R Studio. So that I will show you here. So this is an R Studio environment. If you go through the week one video lectures, it is clearly explained that what is this window. And what you can see in this is an environment and history, and here this is an console, here you can see, and here you can type the code. And here you can see the files, plots, packages, help, and viewer, right? So here, now this is an RStudio environment. And in video lecture, it is clearly explained that what you can do with these four windows in the RStudio IDE, in the RStudio IDE. And this is an R. Now this is an R. So here I can write the code and then I can execute and I can see the output here itself. And you can save that files also. And similarly in RStudio also, you can save the files, everything in detail. It is given in video lectures. You have to go through those video lectures because all the videos take three hours time. Those week one video lectures are 3 hours, max 3.5 hours. So every day you have to go through for at least half an hour or 1 hour video lectures. Then you need to understand those topics, right? So here, now what I said, to install the packages, simply you go through this, open the RStudio and here click on packages. When you click on packages, here install option is available. Yes. So here, what it said, repository, you keep it as it is. Don't disturb anything. Don't disturb any other settings. But yes, working directory you need to set. That is also given in video lecture, that how you can set the working directory, in the sense the path where you want to store all the files, R files. You want to store all the R files or whatever the operation you are performing. You want to save the workspace also, this complete workspace also. You can save that workspace while exiting from the RStudio, it will ask. So all these things they have shown in video lectures, please go through it. So here when you click on this, here packages separate multiple with space or comma. That means what? When you are mentioning here more than one package, simply you give one space, that is enough. Simply you give one space, that is enough. So here if you observe, I'll just show you this. I have already installed the packages, but anyway, let's say that plier and deplier and reshape too. So here what? When I just type this, you can just observe that here it is coming. Then plier and then space, then deplier. Right? So here it is there. With this space, by giving a space between two package names, you can, after selecting this, then simply click on install. Simply click on install. Then those packages will be installed. And here you can see this. And here you can see the packages here. Install. You can see the packages which are installed here. You can see in this window. So like that, you install all these packages in RStudio, like whatever the direction I have given. Click on this packages, click on install, and then specify the package names. Finally, click on install. Then those packages will be installed, but it takes little bit time to install the packages. So in order to, so the, these installation of R and RStudio and as well as installation of packages are mandatory. Without this software installation, you can't learn anything in this course. You can't practice the programs and you can't practice the examples provided for a particular topic. So this installation is mandatory. Without fail, you have to install this, then only you can start learning the course and you can practice the examples provided for particular topics. So here I will give a brief, you know, the precise information about all the week one video lectures. So here, Data Science for Engineers course, Philosophy and Expectation. So in this video one, video one, you can they will give an information about what you can learn from this course. If you learn this course, what you can do. So what we can do, that we can perform the data analysis on different fields by collecting the data. In this video one, introduction to R, what you can learn from this video is that they will explain about how to set the working directory in RStudio and how you can create a file in RStudio and save the file. And once the file is saved in RStudio, then how you can execute the file. Right? So now, next, in this video, continuation of introduction to R, in this video, what you can learn means how to add the comments in R file, how to clear the environment, that means how to clear the environment. Yes. It is audible. Right. Thank you. Okay, fine. Right. So here you have to install all these packages, and in, so in this video three, you are going to learn how you can declare the variables, what are the naming conventions to be followed for declaring the variables, and what are the basic data types available in R. And very, very important thing is that you need to learn the objects, vectors, LIS. So what object means, you are all aware of it, what is object. So vector and list. So vector and lists are very, very important. Vector means we are going to store the ordered collection of same data type. Ordered collection of same data type. List means what? So we are going to store the collection of a different objects. We are going to store the collection of a different objects. So these are very, very important. That what do you mean by a vector and what do you mean by a list? These two topics are very, very important that you need to, that you can learn from this video 3 lecture, variables and data types in R. And next, in another video, so basic data types, you will have an logical, integer, numeric, complex, character. And basic objects, you will have vector, that is ordered collection of same data types. And list, you will have ordered collection of objects. And very, very important topic is that data frame. So data frame is nothing but we are representing the data in a tabular format. Representing the a given data in a tabular format. Obviously, that is the convenient way to display the data and to generate the data so that we can understand easily. So data frames are very, very important. So there are a lot of examples given on this topic. You have to go through all these examples and need to learn. And also they have given in detail that how you can create a vector with the example and how you can create a list with the example. So how to create a list, how to access the list by component names, how we can manipulate the list. So these are very, very important. A data frame. Next in video 4, a data frames are discussed. So in this data frame, you are going to learn that how you are going to represent the data in a tabular format. What do you mean by a data frame? How you can create the data frame? How you can access the rows from table and how you can access the columns from table? Also, how you can edit, how you can modify the existing rows and columns in a table. And also how you can add a new rows and adding a new column to the data frame, to the existing data frame. And this video is very, very important, students. You have to learn this. You have to go through each and every example provided for data frame. So in further lectures also, we are going to use this data frame concept. So you have to learn these things, that how we can create, how we can access the rows and columns, and how we can modify, and how we can add a new row or a column. And here in video 5, once you are aware of what is data frame, in video 5 they have discussed about using the data frame, how you can recast and join the data frames, how you can recast and join the data frames. So here recasting is done in two steps. That is with the help of melt and cast. So you need to learn what do you mean by melt and what do you mean by a cast. So based on this concept, the assignment question is given. Then only you will be able to solve. So recast in first step. So the recasting can be done in two ways. One way is that using melt and cast command. Another way, that is in one step, is using recast command. So we can perform the recasting in two ways with the help of these commands. And how to join the two data frames? So here joining means we can recollect that information from the DBMS, that left join, right join, inner join, right? So full join. And they have given semi-join, anti-join, new topics also. So that those things are also can be learned from this recasting and joining data frames. So this data frames and recasting and joining of data frames are very, very important. Lot of examples are provided. You have to execute those examples with the help of RStudio. R here also, even in R also, you can execute those examples and you can see the result. You can see the result. And in this video 6, you can learn arithmetic, logical and matrix operations. Anyway, you are all aware of what are arithmetic operations and what are logical operations, but you need to concentrate more on matrix operations. You need to concentrate more on matrix operations, where in upcoming topics we are going to perform these matrix operations in week 2 when you start learning the linear algebra concepts and all, right? Next, in video 7, they have given advanced programming in R functions. So here you are going to learn how to write a functions in R. And once you write the functions in R, how to load the functions in R and how you call the functions in R and how do you invoke the functions in R. Remember, in RStudio, like in R, so once you write the function, then directly you cannot call the function and you cannot invoke the function. First, you have to load the function. You have to load directly. Once you write the function, you cannot click on run. So you, here you have a source. Here you have a source. So here you need to click on this option to load that function. To load that function, then only that function will be called and it can be invoked to execute the statements. So those things you can learn from this video, advanced programming in R functions, in video 7. Next, coming to video 8. So here in this video, continuation of advanced programming in R functions, here you are going to learn the MIMO concept in functions, MIMO concept in functions. What do you mean by MIMO concept in functions? Here R functions, that is providing a multiple inputs and also providing an multiple outputs. Have you passed the multiple inputs to the function and how you can achieve the multiple outputs from the function? How you can achieve the multiple outputs from the function? So here, that is, so the very, very important thing is that with the help of examples, how we can pass the different inputs or more than one input and how we can capture the more than one output, and that information can be displayed. So this is also very, very important. Next in, here you are going to learn inline functions also. Apart from MIMO concept using functions, you are going to learn inline functions. So inline function means you are all aware of it. You have learned from C++ subject. You have using C++. So from the in that subject it is given inline functions. What do you mean by that and all? It is given. So instead of calling the function, loading that function, calling that function, activating that function, instead of doing all these things, when we write an inline function, when it is having only a small set of statements, so the function calling itself can replace with the function statement can be executed. So that information is provided here, and also looping over objects. So here you are going to see different loops can be performed on objects. So here we have apply, L apply, T apply, M apply. So all these things you can learn from this functions. That is, you apply a function over the margins of an array or a matrix, or apply a function over a list or a vector. So how you can apply a function over a ragged array. So all these things are very, very important. So what do you mean by a ragged array? And all the examples are given that you can go through it and you can learn. Of course, if there are any doubts, I am ready to clear those doubts. I'm ready to clear those doubts. But before that, you all need to go through the video lectures and learn the concept. And if it is not clear, you have any doubt, then I'm ready to clear that doubt. Next is in video 9. Control structures. So here you are going to learn what do you mean by an if else if family, for loop, nested for loops, for loop with if break and while. So all these things, you know, all these control structures you are already learned in previous semesters, but once again you have to go through that how you can represent these control structures in R. And coming to the video 10, that is the last video in week 1, so how you are going to visualize the data using basic graphs. How you are going to visualize the input data in terms of graphics. That means here we are going to see the scatter, line graph, bar graph. So how you are going to represent the input data in terms of scatter, in terms of line graph, or in terms of bar graph. So those things you can learn, you can work on those examples using RStudio and R. So that's why in order to work on these examples provided in different lectures, you have to install R and RStudio. So it is mandatory. So install and then start working on the examples. Now you have to submit the feedback form and go through the practice assignment, and here assignment is given. Remember, this practice assignment is not used for grading purpose, but whereas this assignment one is used for the grading purpose, and it is mandatory to submit the assignment within the deadline. So here you can see that for this assignment one, this is the due date. So following these dates, before this date, you need to submit the assignment solutions, and the whatever the score you will obtain from this assignment, then that score will be considered for the internal marks. So it is very, very important. So try to go through these assignment questions also. So here first they have given, right? I hope you are all able to view the screen, right? Yes? Can anyone confirm? Yes, thank you. Okay. Thank you. So now here they have given that first question, choose the variable name that is invalid in R. That means what? Out of these 4 variable names, you need to select the variable name which is invalid in R. While naming the variables in R, the condition is that you cannot use the number as a starting alphabet for the variable name. So that's why this is an invalid. How you can check this? data.1 equal to 10 and here 1 data equal to 10, data_1 equal to 10. So how you can check this, that which one is valid or invalid? If you go through the video lectures, you will understand, then quickly you will be able to select the option which is invalid in R. But if you are not able to identify that, then go to the RStudio. So here console will be there. And here first option, data.1 equal to 10, 1 data equal to 10. See, when I executed these two statements, it's not given any error. But as soon as I have given one data equal to 10, it has given an error that unexpected symbol in one data. The reason is what here? You cannot start with the number to define the variable name. You cannot start with the number to declare a variable name. And whereas the fourth option, data underscore 1 equal to 10, so it hasn't given me any error. It hasn't given me any error. That means out of these four options, which one is invalid in R? This is invalid in R. This is invalid in R. So that is the first question answer. Next, second question is what? The command to access help in RStudio. The command to access help in RStudio. So that is what? It's a theoretical question. So that is help of topic. So that we can access the help in RStudio. We can access the help in RStudio. So here, see this. Help of topic is that. The topic is that LM. The topic is that LM. So as soon as I press enter, so here these are the files. Okay, so now you can see this. As soon as I press this enter, you can see this. We are able to access the help for the linear models. For the linear models, the topic is linear models. So I want to access the help in RStudio on a topic called linear models. So here it has given everything in help, LM stats. So fitting linear models, description, usage, arguments, what are all the arguments you can pass, and in detail that information is given. So it's a theoretical question. If you go through this, if you learn all these concepts, then you will be able to identify the answer quickly for the second question. Next, third question. Next, third question is what? In the R code given below, this is an R code given below, the value of I at which the loop breaks. The value of I at which the loop breaks. But anyway, what I will suggest you that I will explain orally and here I will tell the answer. But what I suggest you all is that type this code here and then execute. Then you will be able to understand. So here you cannot copy. So here you have to type here in R and then execute that information. Then you will be able to see the output. But anyway, we need to understand that what this code contains and how we can get the result. Now here what it says, variable is declared as n equal to 100. Another variable is declared, sum, which is assigned as 0. So here we are using an for loop. So in this for loop, so sequence is given here. If you go through these video lectures, then you will understand that what do you mean by a sequence? So in for loop, what they have mentioned, I variable in sequence of 1, n, 3. That means what here? Initially, it will take the value as value of I as what? 1. Initially, for the first iteration, it will take the value of 1 and assign to I. And what is n? What is n here? N is what? 100. 100, 3. So here, first what you are going to get? So you are going to get sum equal to sum plus I. So here initially sum is 0. And then I is what? Initially 1. So now what it is going to do? So sum 0 plus 1 print of, see of this is an concatenation. In R. So print of C of I comma sum. So it is going to display the I value as well as sum value, that is 1 comma 1. Now, is this sum is greater than 15? No. then it goes back here, then it goes back here. So now what it says, every time it increments by 3, I value will be incremented by 3. Every time I value will be incremented by 3. I value will be incremented by 3 here. So next is what here? The I value, next value, and then this n is here only. So here sum equal to sum plus I. It's better that I will type and show you this. Equal to 0, then for I in, then for I in sequence of I 1 comma n comma 3, right? Just open the loop here. Sorry, I should not do this. So now sum equal to sum plus I, right? Sum equal to sum plus I. Somewhere I missed something. Okay, fine. It's better to write down in notepad and then then you can copy it here. M equal to 100, sum equal to 0, and then for I in sequence of 1 comma n comma 3, this sequence you can learn from the video lecture what they have given, and then open. So here sum equal to sum plus I. Right here, we are incrementing the sum and then printing the I value as well as the sum value. Printing the I value as well as the, okay, so here semicolon. So here this is nothing but a concatenation. So print of C of I comma sum. So I am going to print this I value and sum value. So here, whenever the sum value whenever the sum value is greater than 15, then I want to break this for loop. Then the question is what? They ask the question is that at what value of I this break statement will be executed. This break statement will be executed. So here they have given the code that if sum is greater than 15, then break. So now here you can semicolons we will not use here. Right? So here break. Now you can see this. In the first iteration, I will get I value as 1 and sum value as 1. So here initially sum equal to 0, n equal to 100. So here I in sequence of 1 comma n comma 3, that is 1 comma 100 comma 3, every time 3 incremented. So I is 1 here. So now sum equal to sum plus I, so 0 plus 1. So print of C of I comma sum. So that is concatenation of I value and sum value. So we are in the first iteration, I am getting 1, 1. Now see for the second iteration. So why it is not? Thank you. is not found. Around that any other. Next, then jumping to top level. So you can try this code. Actually, I have executed, so I got 10. So now, either you can try from this RStudio or you can try from this R. You can try from this R. So on Friday again I will explain this, and as well as anyway this the library that supports right join. So the join functions are available in dplyr package, so that you can see here. Here I can see this dplyr packages. When I open this dplyr packages, so here you can see the join function. So here you can see that inner join, left join, right join. So here right join. So this right join function is available in dplyr package. So that's why the answer is the library that supports right join function in R is dplyr, right? And similarly, this code and also this example need to work on the data frame, So on Friday, in next class, that is next class is on Friday. So on Friday, I will be explaining this code, third question and the remaining question solutions, along with the second week assignment also, for week one and week two, the assignment's deadline is 18th. So on Friday, I will explain the solutions for the assignment one and as well as for the assignment two, right? Okay, thank you. Right. Thank you all. 1, n, 3 here. So I value 1 will be incremented by 3 for every iteration, for each iteration. So that's why initial it is 1, then next 4, then next 7, next 10. So here sum equal to sum plus I. So here 0 plus 1. So that's why here sum value is 1. Next, when I becomes 4 here. So now what? 4 plus 1, 5. So that's why 4 comma 5. Still sum is not greater than 15. Next, I value will be incremented by 3 for the next iteration. So in third iteration, I value becomes 7. Sum value is 5. So 7 plus 5 is 12. So I value is 7 and sum value is 12. Next, for the fourth iteration, the 7, I value 7 will be incremented by 3. Then I value becomes 10. So here sum equal to sum plus I. So that is what? In previous iteration, the sum value is 12. Now the I value is 10. So 12 plus 10, 22. So 22 is greater than 15. So break statement will be executed. So at value of I, so that is I value, when I value becomes 10, at that iteration, break statement is executed and it will come out of the for loop. So that is the question here. The value of I at which the loop breaks. So the value of when the I value becomes 10, then the loop will be, that break statement will be executed and it will come out of the for loop. Right? Yes. Thank you all. So I kept less than instead of greater than. Okay. Is it clear? For the remaining question solutions and as well as week two assignment solutions, I will discuss on Friday class. So is this clear? Installation of R is mandatory. So make sure that first you complete the task and then start working on the examples provided in video lectures. Right? Is this fine? Are you all following?